वेलकम बैक डियर स्टूडेंट्स। सो इन कंटिन्यूशन विथ द डिजिग्नेशन ऑफ रेप्रेजेंट्स द लास्ट सेशन, सो वी आर सीन इन द लास्ट सेशन द क्लासिफिकेशन एंड द मेजर रेप्रेजेंट्स यूज्ड इन ए वेपर कंबशन सिस्टम एंड हाउ टू नेम द रेप्रेजेंट और हाउ टू रीड द नेम ऑफ द रेप्रेजेंट, द केमिकल नेम एंड हाउ टू डिजिग्नेट इट विथ स्टार्टिंग विथ R and some numbers. So today in this session we will be learning what are the different required properties of an ideal refrigerant. So there are thermophysical, thermodynamic, chemical as well as environmental properties to list the major classifications of the properties before selecting an appropriate refrigerant for the application, whether it is refrigeration or air conditioning. So among these properties, the important properties will be discussed in this session. The first one being the latent heat of vaporization. All of you know that what is latent heat. I hope all of you have studied that, I mean seen the video lecture from the channel itself. The key terms in phase change process is uploaded in thermodynamics. You can see the playlist thermodynamics or thermal engineering, where there is a lecture key terms in phase change process. So from where you can, if you have any doubt in this latent heat, specific heat, etc., you can learn from there. Okay, so I'm not going to discuss elaborately here. So latent heat of vaporization should be as large as possible for an ideal refrigerant, because the required mass flow rate per unit cooling capacity would be reduced. So if the latent heat is, so mass flow rate m into cp, that is the heat absorbed, q is equal to m cp into delta t, right? M into mass flow rate multiplied with the heat capacity multiplied with the delta t. So the latent heat, if it is higher, the mass flow rate of the refrigerant could be reduced. The second property, important property, is the specific heat. So there are two kinds of specific heat: liquid specific heat and vapor specific heat, right? Because refrigeration is a phase change process, not the refrigeration. The refrigerant will be undergoing phase change process in the evaporator as well as in the condenser. So liquid specific heat for an ideal refrigerant should be small, because the degree of subcooling, so subcooling and superheating will be discussed in detail further in the future classes. So the subcooling will be large, leading to smaller amount of flash gas at the evaporator inlet. Similarly, vapor specific heat should be large, so that the degree of superheating will be small. So in any way, this liquid or vapor specific heat is related to the molecular structure of the refrigerant. Now the suction and discharge pressures, the pressure required to be maintained in the evaporator suction side and the exit side or discharge side of the condenser should be low enough to reduce the material cost. So material cost is a major factor. So the pressure plays an important role in the material selection as well as the cost, and must be positive to avoid. So it should not be negative, should be positive. It should not be vacuum pressure, it should be positive gauge pressure. At the same time, it should be as low as possible. Thermal conductivity should be high. Obviously the heat transfer is, conduction heat transfer is directly proportional to thermal conductivity. You have studied from the modes of heat transfer, right? And you know that when the thermal conductivity is higher, heat transfer area could be reduced. So in a heat exchanger, typically the heat transfer modes will be a combination of conduction as well as convection. So conduction will be happening through the tube thickness, tube of the condenser or evaporator. From the liquid to solid surface, it will be by convection. Coming to the property viscosity, you know what is viscosity. It is a resistance to flow, right? It is a fluid property. So it should be small in both the liquid and vapor phases for smaller frictional pressure drops. So if the viscosity is larger, more power will be required and the pressure drops would be more in order to overcome the friction. Critical pressure and critical temperature. What these are? Critical pressure and critical temperature. Again, if you have any doubts, you may again refer to the video lecture I have mentioned earlier. So critical values in pressure and temperature should be high to avoid large power requirements. Should be high. Critical pressure and critical temperature for the refrigerant should be as high as possible. Also, the high critical temperature yields higher COP, coefficient of performance, due to smaller compressor superheat and smaller flash gas losses. Now, coming to the boiling and freezing points, you know, the boiling point as well as freezing point, the definition. The freezing point of the refrigerant should be lower than the lowest operating temperature of the cycle. So, if the cycle is meant to maintain a temperature of minus 10 degrees Celsius, for example, minus 10 degrees Celsius, okay, in the evaporator, the refrigerant boiling point should be lower than that. Sorry, the freezing point should be lower than that. The freezing point of the refrigerant should be, otherwise, what will happen? When the temperature requirement is met in the evaporator, the refrigerant will become frozen. No more flow of the refrigerant will be taking place. It will block, right? It will block the pipeline in the evaporator. It is observed that most of the refrigerant, the ratio of normal boiling point to critical temperature. So previously we have seen the critical temperature. So boiling point to critical temperature is in the range of 0.6 to 0.7. So, there is a normal boiling point is a good indicator of the critical temperature of the refrigerant. Specific volume. Volume per unit mass. Volume of the refrigerant per unit mass should be low so that we can reduce the size of the compressor. Now, coming to the chemical properties, it should be the refrigerant, ideal refrigerant should be non-flammable, non-explosive, non-toxic. If at all, if there some leakage happens, if it comes in contact with some wood items in the case of a refrigerator, so it should be non-toxic, right? So non-corrosive, compatible with the materials of construction of the pipelines or the compressor, wherever it flows. So no bad effects on the stored food material. In the case any leak happens. So all these are the necessary requirements under chemical properties. Again, there should be high miscibility with lubricating oil in the compressor. Now, last but not the least, the safety as well as environmental or eco properties should be eco-friendly. The ozone depletion potential as well as global warming potential. Now, to list a few, the refrigerants in common use are with properties R717 ammonia, R12 freon 12 dichlorodifluoromethane as well as freon 22. These have been in use from time immemorial whenever the refrigeration has been invented. Nowadays, these refrigerants have been replaced by R134A as well as R410, which is an azeotrope. And newer refrigerants are under research so that the global warming potential as well as the ozone depletion potential could be eliminated without the presence of fluorine, chloro. This CFCs as well as this HCFCs could be eliminated. If you have any questions, any feedbacks, please use the comment section below. Thank you for watching. Keep watching. Subscribe and share with your friends. Thank you.